The next question is, every B is A and every C is B, and therefore I say every C is A is which kind of mood problem? Now here you have arrangement as middle term, major term, second term and middle term. So which figure comes into play? The first figure comes into play. That's what we understand. Okay. Now, once you have the first figure that comes into play, I have a conclusion. But my first statement says all B is A. So it's all. In the square of opposition, we have A, E, I, and O. Sorry, we have A, E, I, and O. So that is all, no, some, and some not. Okay. So what we have is all. From the first one, the second one again is all because we say every C is B A, and the third one is again all because we have every, so it's A A A. Now what kind of arrangement it would be? It would be an A A A arrangement. Now in the last session we have already talked about these arrangements are very, very important, and you need to solve these arrangements very, very carefully. I hope that makes it clear. Okay. The next question here is, again very, very direct. We have Ram is mortal because he is a man. All men are mortal. Ram is also a man and therefore he is mortal. Now you have to match the correct one. Hetu is the reason. Okay. So because he is a man is a reason. Okay. Ram is mortal is what? It is the pratigya. Okay, so that's the assertion, the first preposition that I am trying to say. The next statement, all men are mortal, is udharan or an example that I am trying to quote. So udharan in Hindi means example, and that's how you need to understand that. Then Ram is also a mortal is a upnayan, which says there is a kind of universal proposition that comes into play because we are casting this explanation there. And the last says because therefore he is mortal, therefore he is mortal means what? It is the nigam. Okay, so these are the five stages that we understand. The first is the pratigya, then you have the hetu or the reason, udharan or the example, then you have upnayan, which is saying that it's a kind of application of the universal proposition, that is iteration, the universal proposition where we had all men are mortal. Okay. So based on the first pratigya, which is the preposition, we try to understand, we have the pratigya, which is the first preposition, based on which we come on to the udharan, which is a kind of universal proposition, and from this universal preposition we are trying to have the application of it, which is known as upanay. So upanay is where you have Ram is also mortal derived from all men is mortal. Okay, so I hope that's clear again. Now the next question was a question from polity. Now this question talks about the principle of natural justice, here the other party. Now when I say here the other party, what does it actually means? Let's say I am an organization, I am employing number of people. So if I am dismissing something, I have to have a reason, and I have to hear the other party, what does they feel, and they should have a chance to explain it. So that is where I have the dismissal of the employee that is taken into consideration. Then you have supersession of the municipality, where we talk about the kind of punitive actions that take place, and it's a kind of suspension of the members of municipality, but that is again hearable by the other party. When you are suspending someone, you hear whether what they have to say on the issue. And then again, definitely disciplinary action against a student. So students would say, oh no, we did not this, did this, this was done by someone else, or there is some other explanation. So in any case, you have to hear that. But when it's a threat to national security, there is no need for any kind of explanation. So except three, you have the natural justice principle to hear, which is applicable to all other cases, a very, very important aspect. That binary to octal, then hexadecimal, then again binary, and the decimal of fractional binaries and the decimal binaries. Okay, so decimal and fractional in one of the classes, octal hectal in one of the classes, and binary decimal in another classes. So very, very important all of these. So very, very simple, whenever you have a binary number, you want to convert into octal number, you break it into digits of three. So groups of three for octal, groups of 4 for hexadecimal. Very, very simple. So you have 10101. So I have these 3 as one of the numbers. Now these 2 left. I can add as many zeros here. Not an issue on the left hand side. Okay. So I have 2 sets of numbers that are there. I solve this. So this becomes 0 into 2 raised to power 0, 1 into 2 raised to power 1, and 0 into 2 raised to power 2. So that gives me 2. And here I have 1 into 2 raised to power 0. Plus 0 into 2 raised to power 1 and 1 into 2 raised to power 2. So that's 4 plus 1, which is 5. So the first number is 2, the second number is 5. So 25 octal would be my correct answer. A very, very direct and a very, very basic question that is there. Okay. I'm really happy to see there are no doubts so far. So it seems the preparation is going perfect and all of you are working really hard to understand these. The next is the which of the following upaman is also called as the inference by analogy. So when I say inference by analogy, what does it mean? You have samantyo drishta upaman where we see there is reaction between the things, and this is because the two things coexist, and only and when there are two things that coexist, I can say there is inference by analogy. So analogy could be taken into account only when you have two things that coexist, and that's where you have the samantyo drishta upaman that is there, the very, very important aspect where we talk about coexistence. Okay. The next question is, which of the following is the example of a continuous data? Now, continuous data, the very good question here was, why don't we consider population as a continuous data? We consider only those data as its continuous data which could be broken down into further smaller divisions, even fractional divisions. So when I say weight, it is 40 kg, 40.1, 40.2, and it's kind of continuous. I don't say my weight jumps directly from 41 to 40 to 41. It was not one fine day I slept and next fine day I woke up and it was just 50. So there has been a gradual increment into the weight every day, every hour. Okay, so that's where you have a continuous data. But population, it could be in the whole numbers only. So I can say there are 2 people or 3 people. There cannot be 2.3 people. Okay, so this is where we say population is not the option. The same with languages and children. So the only correct option that goes here is weight of the students, which is a continuous data that's there. The next is objective evolution includes what and does not include what. So objective means you are trying to work on numbers, figures, and trying to bring in much more quantitative aspect. Okay, when I say subject, it is a qualitative aspect. Okay, so subjective and objective, that's the major difference. So when I say objective, I'm trying to use statistics, I'm trying to understand the measurability of something, and I'm trying to even say there are inarguable facts. Apple falls due to gravity, it's an inarguable fact, so it's objective. Okay, be it here, be it in America, be it in Australia, this is an inarguable fact, at least on Earth. So that's where you have objectivity that comes in. But when I say a posteriori knowledge, what does it mean? Posteriori knowledge is one which comes with experience. Now, this experience is subjective. I experience a very different aspect when I am taking a class from, let's say, you. Or you experience a very different aspect when you are taking a class here, when you have taken a class somewhere else. So what does it mean? This is your personal experience, which is only and only can be expressed by you, not by anyone else. And that's where we have the objective evaluation that comes into play. The next question is again very, very important. If we want to measure the student participation and engagement while studying a student evaluation, which of these is useful? Now, when we are talking about student evaluation, what do we try to understand? We try to understand that we are focusing on two things. One is the evaluation focus, the other is the information sources. So when I say evaluation process, it includes the participation and the engagement rate by pass out rates, dropout rates, talking about the attitudes, the learning learning strategies. However, when we talk about the information sources, we are talking about attendance, which is the roll return. So students' roll call is very, very important, because this talks about the attendance and the absence in the studies. We also talk about the assessment and the monitoring patterns. So you have C as the only correct option in this case, where we are talking about the informational sources, and these informational sources understand the help us understand the attendance and absence studies. Okay. The next question is a question from analytical reasoning. Now there were lots and lots of questions and problems which are there from the analytical reasoning. So let's do those one by one. I believe so far there has not been any issue in what we have been discussing. Okay, great. So let's move on to this question. Now this question is further an interesting question. I can simply write boys and girls. Okay, now make it very, very systematic. Once you have those as systematically written, everything becomes easier. Okay, so I have these boys and P, Q, R, S, and T. These are the girls. Now my statement says A and D go together. Okay, B cannot be teamed with E. So what cannot be teamed together? I write here B cannot go with E, D cannot go with P, S cannot go with C. Okay, B and R have to be together, so B and R are always together. Then next you have S and T are always together. There have to be four members including E from the boys. What are the members other than E? So total you have to find out six members, of which you have four boys. Sorry, you have four boys, so how many girls? Two girls. Now E is definitely a member. Now E cannot go with B. So if E is going, B would not go, and if B is not going, R would not go. Okay, and then you have A and D that would go together. Okay, so that is again removed. But I can say from the girls I have to pick up only two of the girls, so R is not going. So in case you have S that would go, you would have C that is going. Okay, so C, if that is going, what would happen? You would have C, E, and E is already going, so you would have D that would go. Okay, so if D would go, listen carefully, if D would go, what would happen? I would have to pick any one from D or A. Okay, because if I don't, there would be only three boys that would be left, that is C, E and F, but I have to take four boys. So D would be in any case there. So if D is there, what would be there? A would be there. Okay, but if D and A are there, then you would have P that cannot go. If P cannot go, what would remain is S and T. Okay, so what would remain is S and T. So S and T, because I have to pick up two girls, R cannot go, P cannot go, so only remains is Q, but Q cannot go because S and T would go together. So S and T would go here, so S and T would go here, so you would have A, D, E and S, T that would go for sure. Okay, now since they are going, C cannot go with S. C and S do not go together. So C cannot go because S is going. So who would be left is F. So these would be the people who would be going. A very, very important question. I repeat again. You have the boys and the girls. Four boys go and two girls go. E is going. Now, if I pick up E, I have to pick up four boys. Now, A and D would go together. If I don't consider A and D, what other options are left? B, C, E and F. But since E cannot go with B, so B would not go. And if B would not go, R would also not go. So B cancelled out, R cancelled out. Now you are left with E. So definitely A would go because you have to fill up four seats. So A would go. If A would go, then D would go. So A and D go together. So A and D would go together. Now if A and D are going together, with D, P cannot go. So I remove P. Okay. And if A and D are going, you would have two girls that you have to pick. Now only Q remains, but S and T go together, so S and T would go, Q would not go. So girls are done. Now coming on to boys, since S is going, what would happen? C cannot go, S and C do not go together, so C would not go. So who would be left is F. So that would be the students that would be going, and the question says except E, who would be going? So it would be A, D, F, S and T who would be going. The next question are, there are 5 people and a 5-story building. Now, all of those are living on a different floor. Amit lives above Ajay but below Anand. Okay. Atul lives above Ajay. So, Atul lives above Ajay but below Amit. That's the next set. Anil lives below Anand. So, Anand on the top. And then, but above Atul, so Atul is here. Now these are the arrangements that I have found. Now here I have Amit and Amit, Ajay and Ajay. So Atul would be here. So my final arrangement would be Ajay, Atul, Amit and Anand. That is from these two. So I cut out these two. Now from here, between Anand, which floor does Anil live? I cannot say. It could be third floor or the fourth floor. I can say for sure about the first, second and the top floor that is there. So either third floor or the fourth floor would be the right answer for Anil, because Amit and Anil, I cannot say finally who would be where, because between Anand and Atul, you have Amit, and between Anand and Atul, you have Anil that is there. So those are the two locations that could be possible, but the remaining arrangement that we had already done could be proved from these two. This would help us prove the third scenario, which is this. So we can say either third or fourth floor would be the right option in this case. And coming on to the last question for today. So the last question says, you have a child looking for his father. He wins 90 meters. So he starts from this point, goes 90 meter. Now when he wins 90 meter in the east, he turns to his left. So his left would be this side. So he turns to his left, moves 20. Then again his left, which is this side, he moves 30. Then from this point he would move south, and south how much? 100 meters. So from this you have 100 meters. That means this is 20, this is 80, and this is 30, and this is 60. So I have to find out the starting point from the father. So in this you would have 60 and, excuse me, so you would have 60 and 80 that would be seen. And 60 and 80, when you try to take out the Pythagoras, what would be the answer? The answer would be taken as the, just a second, so back on the last question, we have 60 and 80. Now you have 60 and 80 here. Now you have to take out the Pythagoras, which is square of 60 plus square of 80 under root, which is 3600 plus 6400, which is 10, 100 and 00. So it comes out to be 100. So how much meters he is away is 100 meters as the right answer. So this was the questions that we have discussed today. In the last session, that would be next Friday, we'll be coming up with many more questions. So do let us know in the meanwhile if you have any doubts, any questions that you are facing issues with. So we'll be covering that in the last class, and definitely study well. Looking forward for bright results from your side. Have a wonderful day ahead.